So, how you feeling?
Oh, man, I feel rougher than a bear turd rolling fish hooks.
Yeah, it's pretty bad what you're having to drink.
Oh, man, give me a double ride just on the rocks. My head's throbbing like a young robin today.
Double ride? What about your friend, man? You gonna have a little something now? Lemonade and double ride. Coming right up.
All I know is that there were rumors he was into field hockey.
Yeah, come on over.
There were rumors.
Sorry, bye.
He was gone the next day. It's like, he was gone, they just like, it was like so much fun. They were so, hey. And then the next thing you know, woo!
Thank you. Right, here's a guy. He puts right wrongs. He sees a wrong, he wants to right it straight away, like a man enraged at a poor quality toy boat. But he uses a camera to retilt the wrong into a right, and he makes us laugh as he does it. Michael Moore, still using the old hi there routine? Well, listen, you're known for shouting at buildings. Sometimes it seems that you see a building, you have a compulsion to pull out a megaphone and shout at it. What is it that makes you mad?
Well, I think growing up in a factory town.
Sure, we don't give too much away, but one of the best bits in the new show is when you confront a guy from a medical insurance company who won't give a dying man a new pancreas, and you make us actually want to kill this guy. Mm. It's really is the ultimate hate bender, because we know that he's wrong, he's evil, he's scum. We watch this, we think, I want this guy to drown in his own vomited up pancreas and have his balls chewed off by starving badgers, is what we feel. Now, where do you get the brilliant twist to do that?
But you see, I didn't do it. He did it to himself.
He made us want to hate him himself?
Yes.
And you just stood there like a big mirror.
Well, I just want to choke the guy.
Yeah, mash this guy's face off and kick it around like a football.
Right.
I still want to see that corporate guy in his exploded death state, but like with tears running down my face and solemn music like the sick faux remorse of the psycho.
Right. Well, yeah, because you see, humor is what takes you to that edge.
You mean you can do anything?
That's right.
Do you look at things happening in Europe, things happening in Britain? Do they ever make you go as mad inside? You know, if you hear a story like somebody like this Wug Baspin guy, the pharmaceuticals guy, laid off 175 staff. He laid them off personally, got machines to replace them. Still had time for two rounds of golf before 5 p.m. Wug Baspin, the chemicals guy. Now, what do you say about him?
I say that it needs to be, a law needs to be passed against people like this that put people like that in prison.
But you look at Wug and his big fat face sitting in there in his big fat chair lighting his cigars with the hair of screaming children, and you think, damn it, he needs to go today.
Right, but we know that change is slow, but it never happens unless people start to work for it.
Well, his death is slow.
And, well, I'll tell you what, 100 years from now, it'll be like, that will be the law.
You reckon?
Oh, yeah.
It'll be any kind of future Wug busman who pulls a face at a kid, gonna be banged up for life.
Oh, yeah.
We're onto you, Wug. Whatever you're doing with your made-up company and your made-up of bits and old ones.
You know what, I tell you, you've got me so pissed off about this now, about this guy, that in the next season, well, I am going to do a couple of pieces here in Britain. I'm going to bring over my corporate crime-fighting chicken, Crackers, and I'm going to go after this guy.
I'd like to see your chicken go after Wug.
I'm bringing the chicken over here, and we're going to put people like him in jail.
Mm.
Oh, my God. villain.
Thank you.
drunk, naked DJ who wears himself to jam, jam, jam. One final measure of the abject misery of the self-knowledge. He's distressed. We can hear that now. Now, sobs wrap his body and somehow threaten to spoil the moment for a moment. But now he's back on track, throwing the coil of three core around his neck.
Shifts the night and steps up the edge.
Now before the core pulls tiny shouts, I'm Chris Boyles, please forgive me. And the windows all around fly open and a thousand voices cry out, no fucking way. And as his spine is snapped apart, I'm thinking, God, I hope he heard them.
Come in. Right, now, Sarah Voos, isn't it?
Will do, have a seat.
Thanks.
Right, well, what seems to be the problem?
Well, I've got a really sore neck.
Okay, can I just have a little... How's that now? Bad?
And
this one? Yes. Well, look, there's not a great deal I can do. You could take some painkillers and apply hot and cold flannels to boost the circulation.
Right.
And you could try sticking this under your arm.
Okay, and what is it?
It's Christ's cock and balls.
Oh.
George Carey shat them out last Tuesday while he was buggering his daughter in the Abbey.
Right. What were you doing there?
No, I just popped in to say a prayer or two, and there was the fucker running around, shoving religious relics up his arm.
And they go under my arm?
Yes, I know they're a bit sticky. I'm not sure whether that's Christ's cum liquid or whether it was from the dog that had just been emptying its balls into Carey's rather well-cushioned shit sleeve.
But it's okay, is it?
What, Christ's knob glue? Yes. Mother Teresa had no problem, and her twat was always full of it. She used to smear it on the necks of the sick.
Really?
There was more of the Saviour's dick's knot in there than coke up Di's vag on that fateful night in Paris. Well, let me know if you have any problems.
Yeah. Thanks.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. rape.
Protest is beef burgers. Every July, peas grow there. Do you really mean that?
So in other words, I'd start half a second late.
Don't you think you really want to say July over the snow? Isn't that the fun of it?
If you make it almost when that shot disappears, it'll make my...
I think it's so nice that you see a snow-covered field and say every July, peas grow there. We know a remote farm in Lincolnshire where Mrs. Buckley lives. Every July, peas grow there.
We aren't even in the fields, you see.
We're talking about them growing, and she's picked them.
What?
I don't understand you, then. When must, what must be over for July?
When we get out of that snowy field.
When I was out, we were onto a can of peas, a big dish of peas, when I said in July. Yes, always. I'm always past that.
You are?
Yes. Well, that's about where I say in July.
Could you emphasize a bit in July?
Why? That doesn't make any sense. Sorry. There's no known way of saying an English sentence in which you begin a sentence with in and emphasize it. Get me a jury and show me how you can say in July and I'll go down on you. That's just idiotic, if you'll forgive me by saying so. That's just stupid. In July. I'd love to know how you emphasize in and in July. Impossible. Meaningless.
I think all they were thinking about was that they didn't want to.
He isn't thinking.
Wilson, can we just do one last
one? Yeah?
It was my fault. I said in July. If you can leave every July.
You didn't say it. He said it. Your friend.
Who says Americans can't write books? Well, my school teacher for one did, but she was wrong, and she's dead now. And as if to dance on her grave, this American is all book. His name is Bret Easton Ellis. He's from New York. Now, I want you to imagine a book over 6 feet tall that looks like a man, and then imagine that that book takes you aside, throws open its arms, and sprays words all over your face. It makes you laugh, it makes you cringe with raw satire like guts. Is all this chopper out and slash routine just a big love me thing?
No, not at all. The book...
That incessant brandishing of your chopper in our face saying, love me, love my chopper, I'm slashing all over the place.
Well, yeah. I mean, what I'm motivated by as a writer is, or as a satirist, I think, are things in society that annoy me.
This is kind of anger thing. You know, you're running around and inside your head you're as mad as a one-inch hospital and you've got to get it out somewhere. You look at something, like in your new book, Models, and they make you feel as mad as a crab on telly.
Yeah, I think that's true, and I think it's what this book is about is basically what all my books are about. The warning inherent in all of them is, hey, you know, don't be an idiot.
You did say that it is a kind of revenge. You said that the tyranny of fashion has become so inescapable, we're all trapped. Now, when I read that, it brought a lump to my throat because it's an inescapable truth, and then I just wanted to crawl away and drink tea in a zoo surrounded by creatures that you know vanity.
That's a fair. I would think that is a fair description of the book.
Right.
It's a fair assessment.
I think in an interview quite recently you said that life is scary. What do you think is scary?
Not being able to trust someone. That's very scary.
Mm. I think it's much. It's much scarier.
Yeah.
Yeah. What about governments standing around with their arms folded, nodding?
Scary.
Now you've stuck with the old chapter format thing. Why was that?
What do you mean, in terms of going backwards?
In terms of subdividing the book into separate chapters.
You know what? That's something that I can't really explain or verbalize. I know when I begin writing a book, and I plan the book for quite a long time, and I know a lot of the things that are going to happen in the book, one of them this time out was these the way the chapters were spaced out.
Do you know how many chapters are going to be?
I have a pretty clear idea. Yes, I do.
It does expose you to the accusation that it is all chapter... no book. Where are you going to go with this chapter thing? Right. I want to ask you one thing. I found this on the back page of the book. Can we talk typeface?
Yeah, I don't know what that is. I don't know what that
it's typeface. It's how the words are rendered.
Right.
Yep, so it's like Courier, I suppose, or Geneva, that sort of thing, except
this one is called
Electra. Whose idea was it to use a typeface at all?
No, I think it's the book's designer.
When you read the galley proofs, do you ever sort of go, ooh, let's not have a typeface?
Yes.
And you have the power?
I think sometimes you might.
To say, print that book, but I don't want you to use any typeface at all.
Right.
Place in the American Far West where Charlie Briggs chops up the finest prairie-fed beef and tastes. This is a lot of shit, you know that. You want one more? Yeah, more on what beef?
You missed the first beef, actually, completely.
What do you mean, missed it?
You're emphasizing prairie-fed.
But you can't emphasize beef. That's like he's wanting me to emphasize in before July. Come on, fellas, you're losing your heads. I wouldn't direct any living actor like this in Shakespeare. Will you do this? It's impossible.
Olsen, you did six last year, and by far and away the best, and I know the reason.
The right reading for this is the one I'm giving you.
At the moment.
I spent 20 times more for you people than any other commercial I've ever made. You were such pests. Now, what is it you want?
No, I think
depths of your ignorance, what is it you want? Whatever it is you want, I can't deliver because I just don't see it.
That was absurdity. You
money is worthless. Money is worthless. Money is worthless. Money is worthless.
Thank you. Give thanks to God. We give thanks to God. We give thanks to God. We give thanks to God for those maimed through the evil of Mother Teresa, whose death we treasure. We pray for those most closely affected by her death, among them Trevor the sheep. Lord, we thank you for the precious gift of the sick, the maimed, and all whose lives are damaged, and for the strength we draw from all who are weak, poor, and powerless in this country and throughout the world. Lord, we commend to you Elizabeth, our Queen, whose death may serve the common good. We give thanks above all for her readiness to identify with God Almighty and for the way she gave source to so many people. Her mother, her brother, Dodi Fayed, and many, many, many more. We pray for the royal family as they discharged their members in Trevor Rees-Jones. Give them aids. Lord of landmines, hear our prayer. And now abideth faith, hope, love, these three. But the greatest of these is tortoise.
Going over to Susan's house, walking south down Baxter Street. Nothing hiding behind this picket fence. There's a crazy old woman smashing bottles on the sidewalk where her house burnt down 2 years ago. People say that back then, she really wasn't that crazy.